I think the colonial impact was twofold. One was the creation of those states, 53 states created out of 6,000 created by foreigners. Africans had no part in their creation. But the other factor, and this is a delicate one, and I tread carefully here, is the destruction of belief in Africa, the lack of self-confidence, the feeling that we can't do it. And I think that was also a result of the colonial impact, because I think it was short enough to destroy leadership in Africa. It was short, but not long enough to replace it with anything else. So the old ways, the old political systems were just wiped out by the colonial impact. And with that, any form of political or cultural leadership was obliterated. And it is that loss of self-confidence, which I think was the other thing. I think Frantz Fanon wrote a lot about this. And you feel it. You often, people will say to you in Africa sometimes, I trust you because you're white. I wouldn't trust, and you say, but you trust, you know, we wouldn't trust. And it's that sort of thing, which is, it's changing. It's definitely changing. But I think that was the other devastating impact, which we as outsiders do not see, that loss of self-confidence. And it's, it takes time. It takes generations to restore that pride in Africa. And one of the people who's been very strong on this is Chinua Achebe, the Nigerian novelist. And he went back recently, and I had the privilege of accompanying him on his return to Nigeria for only the second time in 20 years. And he said to them, in your own cultures, you will find the values and the strength that will take you into the future. In your own cultures, and that restoration of self-belief, I think, is critical. China is number one. Number two is mobile phones and the internet. It's had, you know, everybody knows the usual impact of that, and it has changed all our lives. But in Africa, it has made a huge difference. I'll give you some examples. One, market women. You know, it's sitting in a market just with a few oranges, bananas, tomatoes around. We'll be phoning the next market to check the price there. So you get a real economic impact. There's a glut there, so okay, we don't go there, we'll go there. One of the best examples of a Somali, watched a Somali nomad with his herd of goats and cattle waiting to come down out of the mountains to the port to sell his animals, but he checks the price on a mobile phone on the other side of the Red Sea. Unbelievable. He borrows a mobile phone and he's got the number, and he calls up the trader on the other side, what's the price, because I need to know what's the best time to come out of the mountains. All sorts of things like that. But politically too, watching elections in Ghana and radio stations saying, if you see anything dodgy going on, if you see, you know, ballot stuffing or anything like that, call us. And suddenly the radio stations are broadcasting people on mobile phones telling them what's going on in an election. If the elections are announced locally, everybody in the country knows what they are. They can't fix them between the local and the national. All sorts of ways these are transforming Africa. But the third way is the professional middle class, which is growing very fast in Africa, huge, with its huge thirst for education. And in particular, those who've gone abroad now returning to Africa. And I think the creation of that middle class, professional middle class, that do things according to international standards, not to the way we do things in Nigeria or the way we do things in Kenya, but this is the way we do things internationally, that I think will have a huge impact as well.